Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everybody, and welcome to episode 44 of Brains Matter. On today's show, I have part one of an interview with Dr. Mark Boland, accelerator physicist from the Australian Synchrotron. Firstly though, a brain teaser. I'll ask you a question and see if you know the answer. I'll give you the answer at the end of the show. Today's question is, who was the first person to break the sound barrier on the 14th of October 1947? The answer to that later in the show. In the news, Russian schools have decided to throw out using Microsoft Windows on their computers and have moved to the open source operating system Linux. This means that the schools won't have to pay licensing fees for the use of the software. Ever since Russia joined the World Trade Organization, rules around the usage of illegal software became a lot stricter, and since many schools ran illegal copies of Windows, the WTO laws dictated that these schools be prosecuted for using that illegal software. The two options available to them, according to Alexei Smirnov of Alt Linux, was to either pay up a lot of money for Windows licensing, or to go the free software route. And that's the path that was taken. I found it useful for students who better understand software development with Linux, and given that most Russian universities use Linux as well, the decision is proving to be quite popular. A black hole has been discovered in a galaxy far, far away. Well, not that far away in astronomical terms, but it turns out to be the most massive black hole ever found. We all know by now that a black hole is formed when a heavy star that's dying has a core that collapses, and that creates a region with such strong gravitational forces that even light can't escape. The previous largest known black hole was estimated to be about 14 solar masses for a black hole known as GRS 1915 plus 105. The newly discovered black hole is thought to be around 16 solar masses and has a companion star that's thought to be no older than about 3 million years old. Calculations suggest that the companion will die in another 2 to 3 million years, forming another black hole. The other curious fact is that the companion star is about 70 times the size of our Sun, and scientists currently don't know for sure how a black hole formed around such a massive companion star in such a tight orbit. I'd hate to see what happens to matter between the two companions once the companion turns into a black hole as well. I don't know if you've heard of warp speed computing, but it's got nothing to do with Star Trek. Actually related to improving the speed of computers. If you think your current machine is fast enough, you probably know that the CPUs in your computers are quite good at doing the same type of calculation over and over. Far quicker than a human, given that we'd get bored doing the same thing over and over. But the problem is that CPUs are general purpose. They're designed to do various types of calculations. A dedicated circuit will perform a task much faster than a general purpose circuit. Field Programmable Gate Arrays, or FPGAs, have been used for about 20 years for dedicated operations in high-speed electronics. Professor Frank Vahid and PhD student Roman Lisecki at the University of California have used the FPGA concept in a microprocessor to create warp-speed computing. Basically, when a computer program finds a set of instructions it's supposed to undertake, and they're the same instructions over and over, the program automatically moves that code to an onboard FPGA circuit, which runs that section of the program up to 1,000 times faster than the CPU would do normally. Imagine how fast Warcraft would work under those conditions. Today's pin of the episode goes to Dr. Gerard Hammond from Sydney in Australia. Thanks for signing the Frapper map on the webpage, Dr. Hammond. Welcome to Brains Matter. There's been a lot of emails and comments from listeners who've been interested in the Australian Synchrotron, which had its public opening on the 31st of July this year. The Synchrotron is used in areas such as biosciences, medical research, environmental science, agriculture, minerals exploration, material science, engineering, and even forensic science. And today, I'm joined by Dr. Mark Boland, accelerator physicist at the Synchrotron in Clayton, Australia. Welcome, Dr. Boland.
Thanks for having me.
So from my understanding, a synchrotron is a particle accelerator that shoots beams of light at material and then measures the reactions or outcomes of those collisions. Is that pretty accurate in a nutshell?
That's broadly what happens. The difference between a synchrotron light source, as this synchrotron is called, it's using the particles to generate beams of light, which is anything from infrared all the way through up to x-rays. Mm-hmm. So it's different from other types of accelerators that people might have heard of, such as the big ones in Switzerland.
So CERN,
yeah. They actually are designed to smash particles together, whereas if I'm doing my job properly, the particles out there barely touch each other. They just keep going round and generating this synchrotron radiation, which is used to do the science experiment.
To the layperson in the street, what is this synchrotron made up of? How does it work? How does it get put together? You mentioned that it generates radiation from the light going around, but then how do you actually do measurements based on that? How do you actually get information out of materials, for example? The CERN example you gave before, where it actually smashes things together, that's fairly easy to understand. You smash things together and then you see what comes out of it.
Yeah.
So in this one, you don't smash things together, so how do you actually measure what comes out of it?
Right, the answer is twofold. Because my job here as accelerator physicist is to produce the beam, I can answer it in terms of how the beam is produced.
Okay.
And then I can answer it in terms of how it's used.
Okay.
So how it's produced is quite simple. You have essentially an old-fashioned TV tube, which generates the electrons at the very start of the acceleration process. From that TV tube, you accelerate the electrons up to relativistic speeds over a space of about 10 meters. Mm-hmm. And now you've got low energy electrons. You put them into a booster synchrotron, which then accelerates up them to very high energies, up to 3 billion electron volts. And then once you've got those high energy electrons, you put them into a storage ring where they stay for up to 24 hours or more. And as they go around in the storage ring, the electrons generate the x-rays or the light which is used on the samples. So that's the first part of the question. Once you've produced that light, the second part of the question is, well, how do you make measurements with that? What you do is you have a series of devices which focus and select out particular wavelengths of light. So, for example, an infrared beamline will pick out the long wavelength light, mm-hmm. and an x-ray beamline will pick up the shorter wavelength light.
Okay.
You then direct that light towards a sample that you're interested to study. So if you want to look at the surface structure of something, you would use the long wavelength infrared light. Mm-hmm. Or if you wanted to look at the internal structure of something, you would look at with x-rays at your sample. And then the analogy that's often used is that synchrotron's like a giant microscope, but you don't see your samples like you do conventionally with visible light, because your eyes can detect visible light and you can understand and get a feel for what's going on with visible light a lot better because you do it yourself. But what you do is you use other detector systems that can detect infrared and x-ray and use those detector systems as your eyes, and that information gets digitized and put into a computer system which can then interpret with all our knowledge about chemistry and physics and how the world works that we know so far, you can continue to interpret and understand the new information that you're gathering from the synchrotron.
Okay, so it's not just things at the atomic and subatomic level that you can measure, it's things that are a little bit bigger than that as well. Because some of the stuff that I mentioned before, for example, the material science and agriculture, before I came in here, I thought those were probably a little bit too big, from my understanding, for something like a particle accelerator.
Yeah, well, agriculture you can split up, for example, into the biological side of agriculture. So, for example, animal viruses, animal strains. There's also the famous experiment which was done on Farlap's hair, and they found traces of arsenic in his hair. So with a tiny, tiny piece of hair, you can get a great amount of detail from your large sample, say a horse.
Okay.
So it works on a lot of different scales, not just on the obvious scales. The brilliance, pardon the pun, of the synchrotron is that there's very bright light, mm-hmm. so you only need a very small sample to get a lot of data. Okay. Whereas with other devices, you might need a large sample because you're not illuminating it with very much light. It's like when you walk into a room and it's quite dark, you can't see very well. We're turning up the light so you can see, not in a dark room, but in the room of molecular and atomic space.
Okay, and for the listeners at home, there's a lot of stuff happening outside, so if you hear things in the background, it is the synchrotron at work.
In fact, what's happening outside the door here is the construction of the radiation shielding for the medical imaging and therapy beamline, and that's a novel way of imaging the body, finding out in great detail, using the latest techniques of X-ray imaging, where there is some trouble spot in the body, maybe a cancer, and simultaneously treating that using the same beam.
Okay.
So using two techniques to do what otherwise you would have to do in two different experimental stations. So you might have to go and have a scan to find out where a tumour is, mm-hmm. and then go somewhere else with that information and try and hit that spot here. The development in the medical imaging and therapy beamline is that you are to image and treat in the one-stop shop.
Okay, so that's more from the research perspective rather than the treating perspective, isn't it? So you wouldn't have people lining up to walk in here and get something treated.
At the moment, like a lot of high-tech treatments, it is specialised and available only for the few. But you never know. There are developments in Europe where they're using smaller, higher energy synchrotrons with carbon-12 atoms instead of electrons going around, mm-hmm. and they're going to build those and put them in hospitals and use them to treat people en masse.
Okay.
So you don't know what's going to happen with the development.
So how big do they have to be? Because this synchrotron, as for the people at home, we'll go for a walk in a minute, but it's about the size of a football field, and the one in CERN is many, many kilometres wide.
Yeah, the CERN one is in fact 27 kilometres around, and you're essentially limited by your ability to bend the particles in a circle. So the higher the energy of your particle, the harder it is to bend it around in a circle,
okay.
and so the larger your circle has to be. This particle accelerator here is 216 metres in circumference,
mm-hmm.
and that's a combination of a compromise on the available magnetic technology or magnet technology that's around.
Mm-hmm.
So the magnetic force that we can force the particle around in a circle, that'll limit the size and the energy of the beam. So you're making a compromise between existing technology and the synchrotron user community requirements, mm-hmm. and your money. You're making compromises
okay.
all the way, and then our budget and our user community and the size of the building that we wanted determined the size of our accelerator.
Okay, well, I remember when this site used to be a drive-in, a very long time ago.
And in fact, the people promoting this place took advantage of that common knowledge that it used to be a drive-in, and they had these pictures of the synchrotron building at night with these beams of light coming out of the roof as if it was a projection house. So that's worked quite well as a promotional tool.
So before the Australian synchrotron was built, what did researchers in Australia use?
They would use conventional sources. For example, the infrared, you can just buy an infrared source, but it's not as good as a synchrotron source. Or X-ray users, again, there are X-ray tubes which will help you do your research.
Mm-hmm.
Or you would go overseas to, for example, Japan, the US, or Europe, mm-hmm. and use a synchrotron over there. And in fact, Australia's had a program for many, many years which built beamlines at overseas synchrotrons and sent the so-called suitcase scientists from Australia to the overseas labs where they would take their samples and do their experiments over there.
And is that kind of facility available here? So if a scientist in New Zealand wanted to do something, they could send their samples over here and read the results from what comes out?
Exactly. So the New Zealand government and the universities have contributed to the building of this facility.
Okay.
So they are one of the founding partners of this laboratory, so they will indeed be coming over and using it to do science. The other exciting development in synchrotrons in particular is that you can send in a sample to a synchrotron without going there yourself and get sent back the results. So depending on what field of research you're in, the community of that particular type of research is more or less developed in that type of technology, but there are communities where they're at the stage now where you can just prepare a sample, send it off, have it measured, and have the results emailed to you without you having to physically go to the laboratory.
Okay, so you mentioned there was the different type of detectors. How many different type of detectors have you got here? I believe there's 13 beam lines.
There are plans for 13 beam lines. We've got 5 in operation at the moment,
okay.
plus 2 diagnostic beam lines, mm-hmm. which is purely there to look at the electron beam and diagnose how the electron beam is behaving rather than looking at samples on those beam lines.
And just to interrupt for the yeah. people at home, the beam line is a separate light source which has a separate detector, is that correct?
Yes, so as the electron beam goes round, it passes all the beam lines in its travel. So it goes around at 1.4 million times per second.
Mm-hmm.
And as it does that, it passes each of the beam lines and gives off a little bit of its energy as synchrotron radiation, which is the broad spectrum, as we discussed, all the way from visible through infrared, soft X-rays to hard X-rays. So it visits each of those beam lines, and the beam lines come off at a tangent because the electrons that are creating this light, they get bent around in a circle, but the light doesn't feel the magnetic force from the magnet, so it goes straight ahead at a tangent. So
mm-hmm.
one of the analogies is, it's a terrible analogy in terms of the physical process, but in terms of visualizing it, it's not too bad. So the analogy is this: you dip a tennis ball in water, the tennis ball's on a string, and now you whiz the tennis ball around your head on this string, the droplets will come off that wet tennis ball at a tangent in the same way that the photons come off at a tangent.
Okay.
I mean, the physical analogy doesn't mean anything, but just in terms of a visual understanding, that's what's happening.
So the beam lines then are just the receptors rather than the source for light.
That's correct.
Okay. We've mentioned before some of the uses, but what are some of the current projects that are happening here at the synchrotron?
Interestingly, the other day I bumped into an old professor of mine, and he was down at the infrared beam line, and there was a case in front of the court on art fraud. So, as we discussed before, the infrared is a long wavelength light,
mm-hmm.
so that's looking at the surface structure or just below the surface structure.
Yep.
So the infrared beam line was used to analyze the surface composition of the in fact, it was an Aboriginal art painting, and there was a court case as to whether that was an authentic painting or not. So that's one of the more sexy things that are going on. There's some other more almost factory-like process of characterizing proteins. So what they do is they crystallize a protein, either from an animal or from the human body, and then put that in the beam in a production-like process where there's a robot that sits inside that steel structure that we'll see later on the tour,
mm-hmm.
and change a sample, and it takes only a few minutes to measure the scattering pattern of the X-rays off that sample, and it gives you, with some very clever mathematical, physical and chemical modelling, a 3D picture of that protein. So if you're designing a drug and you want to inhibit the protein, for example, then you would now have a 3D map of how you could attack this protein and where you could attach certain drugs. So with your knowledge of chemistry, mm-hmm. you can then design a drug which will attach itself to that protein, or a virus if you could image that, or lots of applications on the medical side of things.
Okay, so if you didn't have a facility like this, how long in general would that type of understanding take? So figuring out what the shape of those proteins are and then figuring out where these drugs can plug into that molecule.
In certain cases, in certain cases you couldn't do that research at all because your signal to noise ratio would be too poor to understand the structure. But in a situation where you could do that sort of crystallography, for example, what Watson and Crick did with the DNA, they discovered that it was a helical structure through exactly this process of scattering X-rays off the atoms. You could do it, but it would take many, many times longer. You wouldn't have a robot arm in there changing samples every few minutes. It might take hours or days, which would mean that your data would be compromised in the quality.
Okay.
You can find some images of the synchrotron on the Brains Matter website in this show's entry. And now for some listener feedback. From Nicholas in Melbourne in Australia. Your podcasts are fantastic. Keep up the good work. Thanks for that, Nicholas. And I want to thank you for the links you sent me. The sites have some very useful information in them. Andrew from Mount Eliza sent in an email last week which said, "Congratulations on the anniversary." Thanks for that, Andrew. When I first started the show, I'd no idea how long it'd last or how much interest there'd be in it. But 1 year on, it's still going, and hopefully you'll agree that it's better as time goes on. Alan left a message on the site and said, "Congratulations on the 1 year, keep it up." I certainly plan to, Alan, and thank you. And James Ballard said, "I mostly just wanted to say thanks and congratulations on your 1 year anniversary." Many thanks, James, for the email and all your other support and advice. Now it's time for the answer to today's brain teaser. Who was the first person to break the sound barrier on the 14th of October 1947? The answer to that is Captain Chuck Yeager, who broke the sound barrier in the Bell X-1 rocket. Join me in the next episode to hear the conclusion to the interview with Dr. Mark Boland about the Australian Synchrotron. I'll leave you with a quote from Aristotle: "Happiness depends on ourselves." Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brains Matter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right-hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.